Yes.
Let me finish. Let me finish.
Yes.
Don't you fucking touch it.
Oh. Awesome. Finish. Finish. Good man.
That's what it's all about, boys. It's just bench press. That's all I want to do now. Forget this calisthenics.
Will we see a point where the calisthenics stops?
It's weird to say it, but I feel like CrossFit is the answer.
Hey guys, Daniel Vadnal here for FitnessFAQs. I'm here with the master coach, Eugene, for a juicy chest workout.
Let's get to it.
Let's go.
So when's the last, like, you've done bench for like 4 weeks now.
Yeah.
When was the last time you did it before then?
Never.
Ever?
No.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah. So when I was like starting, people would see the physique and be like, how much do you bench, bro? And it's like, I got to backpedal and say, I've done calisthenics, so push-ups, dips.
I would have sworn you would have done some, like, even like as a 15-year-old in the gym, I might do, you know, a couple of months of just benching.
No, because my intro was a calisthenics park, so it was just the setup wasn't bench press.
Wow. We got to max him out today.
Let's go. I already feel the pump.
Because you've done like squats and deadlifts.
Yeah.
You've done those, but you've done like pull downs and whatnot.
Yeah.
What the f***?
I think I've done it all backwards. That's why I'm invigorated now to do some bench, because I don't know how it feels, how I can progress, what it feels to actually overload the chest in this range of motion.
Okay. I'm going to give you a few more cues then.
Yeah.
I'll coach you up a little bit more on this.
For chest, what am I going for here? Am I going wide grip, close grip?
What do you normally do? You said you've just started bench pressing again.
So just outside shoulder width.
I'll tell you what, the amount of people I've put onto just a closer grip or a medium grip bench as opposed to the wider grip, which is perfect for you there,
they just feel their chest so much more, even if the weight takes a bit of a hit.
Especially if the goal is hypertrophy, it's about finding that happy medium.
Yeah. Like I've bench pressed 150 kilos before.
Yeah.
Okay. Which is it was more than double body weight at the time. But it was with a big powerlifter arch, a perfectly legal powerlifter arch,
yep.
And a grip with my nose picking finger on the ring out here. And the range of motion was like that.
Very short, yeah.
Which is like, yeah, it's impressive. It's a lot of weight, yep. But I think there's something cooler about doing it in the more honest way. You know, when you actually gotta travel the bar through some kind of a range of motion.
It's that whole getting more out of less weight. If you can make 60, 80 kilos feel like 100, then especially if the goal is building muscle, that does make a lot of sense.
Yeah, absolutely.
For barbell bench, what a rep range for working sets do you like, especially as a first exercise?
So this is where I've changed a lot. So now I'm doing like between sets of 8 to 15.
Yeah.
Traditionally in the past, when I cared about just max weight on the bar, it'd be like 3 to 6-ish. But now I use it as a overall upper body strength and muscle building thing. So it's a little bit higher. Just another way for me to kind of also limit weight.
Yeah.
From overall loading, because this is something that I just don't chase anymore. I don't care about.
Understand.
Max weight on the bar. I feel like this is like the growing up is when you start doing this in the gym or whatever.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Is this the over 30s gym epiphany that you tend to have?
Maybe. Yeah. This is like the post-injury Eugene thing, you know? But I actually just quite enjoy it. I just feel like I'm getting a lot more out of my bench pressing from doing this consistently.
Yeah.
Like if I went heavier, lower reps, slightly wider grip, I would still feel great 9 times out of 10.
Yeah.
But that one time.
That's all it takes.
Where yeah. I just feel a little bit and it just my head. Whereas this method, 10 times out of 10, it's always good. And I'd rather that.
Especially as you get more intermediate to advanced, it's not just one killer workout where you progress. It's about the accumulation of workout after workout for say 6-8 weeks. You can't do that if you're injured. So this more sensible approach of just moderate loads, I'm really embracing that a lot these days too.
But you know, it's not cool.
No, it's not. I mean, it's less sexy for Instagram, but it's the longevity that we're chasing these days.
Yeah. Let's go 60. Yeah, that'll probably be my first work set on 60.
Okay, let's do that.
Which I'm
just
cool
use really
with.
Good form and stuff, yeah.
Yeah. Oh, I mean, if you think you'll go to 80, you're not.
Oh, I'm not getting out of it, am I?
You're not getting out of it.
Yeah.
Now, one thing that I've got no explanation for, that you might with your background, is you put your head up. And you see a lot of guys, usually it's a lot of bros in the gym, they'll get like big 100-pound dumbbells and be like,
you're looking forward,
when they press. Now you don't do that, but you're strategically having your head in one place while you press. I haven't been able to find any reason as to why it's good or bad, or why each people should avoid or why it happens.
Yeah, what I see, it's more having a consistent reference point of your visual system is what you get skillful at. So if I always bench looking in the same direction, I think my form will be more consistent.
Right.
And it's just arbitrary. I'm just choosing that way.
Right.
Some other people might look
up. Yeah, for me, I'm head back and up, because I like my head back on something, I guess.
Yeah.
But you don't mind having your head floating in space.
No, especially because I'm new to the movement. I feel a lot of inconsistency with my bar path. So it's like when I feel, I'm doing like a guillotine press, but I'm trying to do it more like mid-chest, I have that like visual feedback as well.
Right.
Great eccentric control. There's a pause at the bottom. Every rep looks similar. Very easy to standardize. Now that's all that's left for Eugene is to bring the effort relative to failure, giving himself enough volume to get that girth in those juicy pecs. I'll try not to make him laugh as he's doing this, but nice. Great, nice. So what I wanted to ask you about is bar path for bench press, because I know that when I'm benching, I should keep my scaps retracted to have a nice stable base, nice platform to push off. Where should the bar be going? Like, is it relative to grip or?
Everyone's so different with it. It will change. Like if you go a wider grip versus a closer grip, that will change where the bar ends up.
Because it changes relative distance of like elbow positioning.
Yep. There's a rough window between like just below the nipple line to just above the nipple line, roughly.
Yeah.
But as long as it's consistent and it feels good for you, that's what it should be. It'll also change depending on how much of an arch you end up creating, which you're not doing, which I wouldn't even worry about.
Okay.
Like, I don't worry. You see, I'm quite flat-backed as well.
Yeah, because I'm not arching because, as you said earlier, I'm trying to maximize range of motion.
Yeah.
By having a flatter back, I can get more extension.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So I wouldn't even worry about that. It looks comfortable. It looks consistent.
Yeah.
You're not doing anything where it seems like let's say you were taking quite a narrow grip, which normally a narrower grip does mean you'll come down a little bit lower on the lower nipple to the upper rib area, usually. If you are instead coming like to your upper chest, I was like, okay, that's just not fucking bench press anymore. It's a JM press. But as long as you're not doing that,
I'm within
it's
the
fine.
Zone.
You're within the zone.
Yeah.
All right, so come on in and I'll talk you through this set as we go on. But we want to try to get as much as we can out of the chest here.
So what am I looking for? Slow eccentrics.
Slow eccentric, a pause. And when you get to that lockout, you like to hold there. Don't.
Oh yeah. So in calisthenics, we always...
You want the strong turnout.
Turnout, lockout, get rid of that.
Yeah, get rid of that.
Wait, no external rotation? Since I've got to eat it.
Snap the bar in half.
Okay. Get those rear delts.
Yeah.
Okay.
So like 3 to 4 seconds down, good couple of seconds back down. Even that pause at the top, try to eliminate that.
Now pause at the bottom though. Pause at the bottom. Even longer. Good, even slower on the way down. Perfect. Good. Pull your chest to the bar at the bottom there. That's better. And again, pull your chest to the bar and up. Good, and again. Pause, go. One more, control it, slow, pause, up. Good, back. Now, to be perfectly honest with you and for you guys watching, having that slight pause at the top or slight no pause, it makes a very marginal difference. For us, it does create more fatigue in the muscle, which means you'll stop the set faster, maybe a little bit less weight, which for what we're training for here is, hey, that's a good thing. You know, it preserves us, we're still getting the maximum stimulus. And that's what we're trying to really go for here. The whole Mark Israetel thing, stimulus to fatigue.
Yep.
Maximize stimulus, minimize fatigue, and minimize weight required. Because we don't care about that, for this context anyway.
That's interesting because on the surface, you'd think that with the weights being lower, that it's not challenging, but it takes a conscious effort to embrace the difficult. Like I have to constantly think, slow, 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 pause, up fast. My body wants to go quick.
Yes.
It is such a huge mental thing because you have to be constantly present. And this is the one time where I do start to appreciate when people are like, oh my God, lifting in the gym is like meditation or whatever.
Well, bodybuilding is, yeah.
It can be because you've got to be so in tune. You've got to be present. You can't stop for a split second because if you stop thinking, you'll pause at the top.
Yeah.
You'll rush the eccentric. You'll lose that pause. And every time you do that, you are minimizing the stimulus while still creating more fatigue. And again, like in the grand scheme of things, who cares? It's 1% here and there, but we must care about that percent at the moment while we can.
It standardizes your effort too, because then you can compare your numbers and know that it's a tempo matched in a sense.
Yes, this is like the true anti-ego lifting, I would call it, because it's, I know if I added that pause at the top, if I went a little bit faster on the way down, if I had no pause at the bottom.
20% more
repetitions. It'd be more reps, so, yeah. More weight. And I would actually improve. Like, it's not a bad thing to do that. But I'm saying, no, don't do those things so I can still get the exact same muscle building benefit.
Let's go for 12. This is 10. Go on, Eugene. Yes. That effort there seemed tolerable for you.
Yes. Tolerable. Like if I really ask myself how many reps could I have really done with the exact same technique?
I reckon you could have got 20. I reckon you could have got 20, yeah.
I don't.
If you brought in some calisthenics, lockout pause,
true.
Like myo rep
action. Okay, yeah. If we really sent it for that, yes. But keeping the exact same technique that I was doing, I'd say probably 3 to 4.
Okay.
If I really wanted to like keep the exact same tempo pauses.
Yeah.
But if I added in the extra pause, if I added in the extra drop here and
or
there.
Or if you sped up the eccentric, then you would have gotten more. Okay. What do you guys think in the comment section? Was I being too ambitious? Could Eugene have done 15? Find out on the next episode.
Everyone's going to roast and be like, Eugene was a little bitch.
Yeah.
Yeah, we know that's coming. So one thing that I'll do an extra cue for you now is, I did say in the last set, but really at the bottom there, be mindful of thinking about
chest up.
I don't like thinking chest up. I like thinking pulling back, which does the same thing.
Was I seemingly a bit like this a bit more?
No, you were completely fine. This is more just like an internal cue for you to think about just pulling back. It's not arching your back more. It's literally just pulling elbows behind you because that's what creates that extension of the shoulder joint, which is the stretch in the chest.
Yep.
Which is different to you just saying, arch more. There's no change to the shoulder joint.
Look at what we're working.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. So pull back at the bottom there. Good. Perfect. Good pause. Slightly longer on that pause and pull it back at the bottom. Pull it back. Yes. Almost sink it into your chest by pulling it into you. Don't let it drop down there. Yes. And again. Awesome. Perfect rep. Do that again. Yes. Control it, pull it back. Yes, keep it going, Daniel. Control it, pull it back.
Two more.
Yeah, you got them. Pull it back. Last one. Yes.
Let me finish.
Yes.
Don't you f***ing touch it.
Oh.
That's what it's all about, boys. This is bench press. That's all I want to do now. Forget this calisthenics. Well, thanks for the tip. I definitely felt the tension at the bottom.
Yeah, like, how's your chest feeling right now?
I feel a slight pump. I feel a bit of muscle damage there.
Okay.
Yeah, a bit of disruption.
Yeah.
And I'm ready for some more.
Ready for some more, great. Next up, we are doing dumbbell incline bench press. Gonna get a monstrous stretch through the entire pec, not just the upper chest. But yeah, this is hitting the angle that we want, which is like that 30 to 45-ish window.
Yep.
Let's just use this, just for funsies. Let's start with maybe the 35 pounders, which is about like 16-ish kilos. But yes, this does reduce a lot of the inevitable arching that does occur, which isn't necessarily a bad thing. But you know, if we just want chest, why not? All right.
Well, that feels quite different, yeah.
So one thing, what you're doing now is absolutely perfect. I am curious how we might go in terms of your chest if you were to take a slightly more neutral grip Just so you can open into deeper shoulder extension. Oh, yeah. We're slightly pulling out.
Hello, almost. Boys. Wow, yeah. that's quite intense.
Yeah, very subtle. And honestly, it won't change your strength that much, which is what I like about it, because you're still able to lift the same kind of weight.
How about this like off neutral? So instead of being like this, I can be like...
Yeah, like okay? Off neutral, semi-pronated, whatever the cool kids call it these days. Yeah, you'll find something that feels good around there. Yeah, what I really like when pressing is most people stay in that just straight vertical up and down. Just at the bottom there, trying to accentuate a slight opening out. Very subtle.
100% yeah. Felt that when you yeah. Explained that, yeah. I could see the advantage of dumbbell incline press being that converging motion of the hands, getting that adduction, contraction. Slight difference to the barbell bench that we were just doing before. Got some quite good shoulder extension mobility there with that.
Yeah, I've been training specifically for that the last couple of months.
You can see the humeral head staying really centered, even at deep stretch, that's awesome. Yeah, good, because you see like some people are told, oh, you go deep, use full range of motion on your incline, but their shoulder mobility is lacking and they're just dumping forward like this.
Yeah.
You've got to choose what your deepest range yes. of motion is. So
absolutely. And there's a difference between like you actively getting yourself there versus the weight pulling you into a position, like active versus passive range.
Yeah.
Like we can probably get you even deeper than you are, even me deeper than I am yeah. by force and by relaxation, but it's probably not a good idea because you're not strong
depends
there.
Depends on the goal. Like what you just said, if you're trying to maximize flexibility, sure, but
yes.
you're also not throwing up the,
yeah.
the 35s yeah. on incline.
Totally.
Because most people that get into training, they'll, okay, tick the box, full range of motion, but they're just dumping down into it.
Yeah.
It's that final bit is where a lot of that magic happens, like actually controlling it down to that end coming out.
Yeah.
What you told me before was the continuous reps, that's new to me, so I'll
yes.
keep the top.
Yeah, yeah.
Just a challenge, not that it's like,
it's not an essential thing, it's just how I like to do things, so it's correct and everybody must do it that way.
Okay, if I
but
want
you're
to build
zero gains.
So I want to get this upper shelf popping, I have to do that. And
I feel like you got a bigger upper shelf than me, so I can't really tell you what to do.
my theory's lacking, but I've got the yeah. dip pecs.
I feel like I'm just a redundant force in this conversation right now.
Rep inconsistency.
Yeah, keep it controlled. Pause it there. Yes, good, good. And actively pull down. Perfect, good, good. Think smooth out of the bottom. Don't throw it. Yes. Awesome. Yes, you got this. Smooth. Awesome. Finish. Good man.
And eccentric.
Yes. Stretch it down.
Oh. What I found with my body with benching, I control the eccentric, but not the entire part. I tend to skip the top.
Yep.
So I'll go like, oop,
yep.
then do it. So I'm, for future workouts, I would make a concerted effort to try the top all the way down slow.
The top half is the least productive part.
Okay.
So you can skip that.
So that's just me just like,
yeah.
technically trying to do it perfect, but
yeah.
it's not perfect for the goal.
Yeah.
It's not required.
Yeah, because like when you think about when is the chest most active in this, when does it get under the most
deep stretch,
it's here, it's the bottom half.
Yeah.
The first half, we're only getting through it just so you can get to the bottom half. So if you want to rush it, as long as it doesn't carry over to the second half, we're good.
True.
Because let's say you were to focus that hard in that first half and then it made you more mentally fatigued. And
yeah.
or just bored in the
yeah,
session.
Yeah,
you're like,
yeah.
I'm sick of this shit. Or you're bracing for longer.
Yeah.
That's less productive.
Yes, it's taking my mind away from what I should be doing.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Stretch.
Yeah. Awesome stretch. So a lot of people would think that like an incline press like this is all upper chest. But if you come around to like this back 45 is short, and you'll see even like his lower pec around towards down the side there, that's getting a big stretch. And it's working to pull his arm up as he presses, which is what you get through this like between 15 to 30-ish, 45-ish degree incline. You're still gonna get a lot of overall pec, depending on how much you arch as well. Keep that stretch.
Stretch it. Yes.
I'll just do one more.
Yeah, control. Pause. Yes. Now eccentric. Pull it back slow, really slow. Feel it out.
Oh, yep.
What are you feeling like? Are you getting like a pretty strong pump through your chest?
Yeah, it's more just like the pec itself. I'm not feeling like specifically a spot or anything, so. Yeah.
How'd that compare to like calisthenics stuff? Like if you're doing, I don't know, yeah, what's an upper body pressing workout you
would do? I mean, because of this, because the torso is stabilized, I'm more able to like genuinely challenge the pec.
Yeah.
Whereas other like presses, like a, it's like a dip or something, you've got more like anterior delt, tricep. I can kind of wiggle my way in that movement to take tension off the chest.
Yeah.
Whereas this, it's just chest.
Yeah, there's nowhere to go. It's just beak down on the chest.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's good. So is this a normal phenomenon I'm experiencing here, getting the left side is not locking out, my right side is?
I'm the same actually. I've got a gimpy left arm as well.
Oh, that's the scientific term?
Gimpy. Yeah, gimpy.
Okay,
yeah.
Come on.
Yeah, it just doesn't want to do its thing. Yeah. Do you have like a strong side?
The right is my dominant, yeah.
Yeah, like I'm right, you're right-handed? Right-handed. Yeah. Yeah, my entire left side is just not a good happy camper.
It's gimp.
Yeah, it's gimp.
It's full gimp.
It is gimp. And I was saying like, also the better that I get at muscle building, the worse I get at other things.
Yeah, exactly. So this technique is chasing difficult as opposed to efficient. So yes, you're inherently going to be less strong because of the technique you're using.
Yeah.
If you spent 4 weeks, fast eccentric, bounce out of the bottom, stretch reflex, night and day different. Mm. Hence why your bodybuilding technique has that slight like specificity to it.
Yeah. This is like, I don't mean to say it as if this is a bad thing, the law of specificity, where bodybuilding training, true bodybuilding training in my opinion, it's slow and controlled, a lot of stretch emphasis, you're removing the stretch reflex. There is no athletic context where that's a good idea. You know, I've been training with a couple of gymnasts recently
and like I might have more muscle mass than them, but they have so much strength and just raw power and elasticity that I can't do.
Like the average person's goals is to have a bit of everything.
Yeah,
jack of all trades. Yeah. You don't want to be a master.
Exactly.
And
exactly.
The time commitment required to do that and effort to get to a decent level, it's not like a complete sacrifice. Whereas if you want to go to the top of powerlifting, you can't be doing much more than squat, bench, deadlift most of the time.
Yeah. Thick ass chest pump.
Yeah, that's it. With these long 4 minute, 5 minute rests.
No, we're telling YouTube it's like 1 minute rest. This is,
and we're right back at it, guys.
Yeah, dripping in sweat, 20 seconds off.
Yeah.
We're going for it.
Yeah. That's such a good stretch. That's great. The arms are almost in the direction of the pec fibers. He's getting scientific on this whilst also training hard. I love it. This is good. Nice. We doing some stretch partials here, Eugene?
Yeah, why not?
So another teaching lesson here, guys. If you want to add some volume and go beyond your capacity and increase hypertrophy, a couple of stretch partials there at the last set goes a really long way to give a bit more, more something in there, huh?
That was totally intentional. It wasn't just me failing.
We scripted that before this video.
Yeah.
Well done.
Thanks for watching, lovely people. Click here to watch another Fitness FAQs video and keep on learning. See you next time.